Welcome to the Coaching Call. Today is February 4th, 2016. We're already a month into 2016. Unreal. I don't know. So anyways, I'm glad everybody could attend here. We've got some, get your questions ready. We'll have plenty of time for questions here. So what I want to start off talking about right now is a concept called disruption. There's a book entitled Disruption, and I just recently read it. So I'm going to share some information on that. I think it'll be of value. It certainly was of value to me on that end of it. So what the heck is disruption? Well, disruption is, it's kind of a perfect way to describe it, is one of my favorite scenes from Indiana Jones. And I'm sure you all recognize that scene on there. I remember as a boy sitting in the movie theater, and just the entire movie theater just was kind of quiet. It's kind of a tense scene, and then just everybody broke out in this really deep laughter. But on here, so disruption to a business, to like business models on that, is kind of what Indiana Jones's revolver is to the sword. So when a disruptor is introduced into the world, it's pretty much kind of destroys the competition or the old business model. So, you know, once the revolver was kind of introduced on that into the world, it really changed the whole kind of business world of sorts, right? And I think that scene just depicts it perfectly. It's kind of like, you know what? Everybody's got all these swords, and that's how everyone fights, and they do their arms and stuff. And then he just pulls out the gun, and he just looks at him like, no big deal, and just blows him away. And so from that point forever on, it's changed everything. And you can't go back at that point, right? You can't reverse back and go, you know what? I'm just going to stick with my sword. Doesn't work, right? You have to move forward, and the entire marketplace on that has been forever changed. Some colonies, some countries didn't realize that. The country that kind of took over Rome, the Ottomans after that, and they technically ruled the world at that point. And, you know, Spain used to rule the world. And so, anyways, they didn't want to adopt a major disruptor at that time, which was the printing press. And so they banned the printing press. And it's kind of like a country when everyone else has revolvers and your country only has swords, you're going to get destroyed. And when everyone else's country, people are getting educated and information is passing at a faster pace, when information passes at a, the speed of information equals the speed of change. Right now we have the fastest information transfer in human history, thus the fastest changes. Anyways, so if you do not keep up with the disruptors on that, you are going to be left behind. So you know, when you have a service or a product, right, and it's disruptive, it creates an entirely new marketplace, okay? And it also creates a whole new set of consumers on that, and it really destroys or at least displaces the product or service that it replaced on here. Some examples of this on that are email versus postal mail, right? Or Wikipedia versus like that 12 volume. I think we even had more. It was like a 24 volume now that I think about it. Encyclopedia. And there'd be like encyclopedia. I'm totally aging myself here, but I remember when they had door-to-door salesmen for encyclopedias, and we had a whole set of encyclopedias in we proudly presented in our living room. They were in alphabetical order and stuff. There had to be more than 12, but anyways, Travelocity. Orbiz versus travel agents, right? The Travelocity is a complete disruptor, and it has taken travel agencies. I remember when I was back in 1980, geez, this is back in, I think back in 1988, when I first left the States for 4 years. I traveled, I did some volunteer work in Nepal. I went there for 3 months and decided at the end of 3 months I didn't want to go back. I stayed there for 4 years. But anyways, I bought my ticket, not online. There was no online to buy your ticket. I would call the travel agents. And they called them, for the international ones, they called them bucket agents. You know, they would buy whole rows and they call them buckets of seats. And they'd try to sell them for as much as they could. Anyways, Uber versus taxi market. They don't have Uber in Spain. Why don't they have Uber in Spain? Just like the Ottomans didn't want the printing press on that end of it. And that's why Spain is going to go bankrupt. My prediction will be the next Greece. But anyways, Uber's a win-win for everybody. Actually, taxi drivers, if they just drive their own cars, they actually make more money. And the consumer pays less. It's just a win-win. So any kind of governments that try to control that are crazy. But I'm really looking forward to using my Uber app on my phone soon when I come to Vegas. Anyways, these are just a few of many, many examples of disruption businesses out there. So as soon as these disruptors are introduced in the marketplace, it changes these industries forever. Airbnb is another one, Airbnb versus hotels. By the way, there's parts of Europe and the world where they don't allow Airbnb. They will also go down like everybody else who doesn't allow the printing press. So nowadays, with this increase of technology, like we were talking about, I was mentioning earlier, the speed at which information can be exchanged and the volume can be exchanged within people, that speeds up change on this. This also speeds up disruptors on this end of it. So anyone has the power to disrupt, to disturb, and nobody is immune to it. Okay, nobody. It doesn't matter how big of a company you are. I'll give you some examples of companies that thought they were too big for disruptors, and they weren't. So the thing to remember is that this is, I'm starting to swing back to how this applies to you. Disruptors create opportunities, a lot of opportunities. And disruptors can be anyone that captures the value. There's a lot of kind of like value fallout. It's kind of it's a bad example, but like a nuclear fallout. It's like a disruptor. There's a lot of fallout of value and all kinds of other sub-businesses that are built and grown and on that end of it. But everyone thinks that disrupting the world on that. But before we can change, a lot of business people, I've been faulty of this, and I think a lot of people are, because we're really all not that different, is they think that when they want to grow a business or do business, that they have to be the next disruptor. They got to invent the next Uber. They got to invent the next Airbnb. They got to do the next Facebook and so on and so forth. And that's just absolutely not true. In fact, you're not even qualified to do that or capable of doing that until you've taken this disruptor model to your own self, to your own beliefs on here. Because our success is really determined by our own internal beliefs about ourselves and what we believe is possible. And those are the first disruptors you want to be focusing on is your own personal ones, rather than what everyone else is thinking about. I want to be the next disruptor. I want to be the next I want to be the next YouTube. I want to be the next Facebook. I want to be the next Wikipedia, the next Tumblr, the next WordPress. No. There's a lot of fallout from there, and there's a lot of room for being a disruptor in that fallout, plenty of room. But you can't even get there or even take advantage of it unless you take care of your own. You become a disruptor in your own personal area out here. So our first disruption should not be on trying to create the next service or technology. Unless, but there's a few people that are able to just go out and do that. But it really shouldn't be your main focus on that. What we should get, what happens is that we end up getting a lot of external data input from the world of what is possible, what we should go do, should we go to college, don't take risks, get a good job, so have good health care. I mean, have you heard that? No, just go out and get a good job because you're going to get good health care and good job security and get a retirement, a 401k plan on that. And we end up internalizing these outside messages and we start kind of believing these outside voices on here. We had, I talked a little bit about it, but I didn't share much, but it does labor on this point right here. Is that I shared a little screenshot of my son doing some, he's got a little robot that he built and he's programming it and stuff. And even out here in Barcelona, Spain, they had a MIT graduate who graduated in a PhD in robotics. And now he works for some kind of NASA race car company. Anyways, he was out here for a week teaching kids about robotics and stuff like this. And it was kind of a week where they were also getting kids, my son is 13, to start thinking about college and moving on. And my kid is extremely bright. And I'm not just saying that because he's like my kid and I'm blinded by how great I think my kid is. It's just a reality. The school voluntarily bumped him up 2 grades. He just has a great personality. Teachers love him. Kids love him. Parents love him. And the MIT professor that came here, he's kind of a young kid. Actually, I call him kid. I'm 50. He's 34. But just looked at J1 and said, man, this kid's got the most potential, blah, 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 and stuff. And so they went around the room and they asked the kids, you know, okay, so this is kind of college week and you start thinking about your future, all this kind of stuff. And so they asked the kids, you know, have you thought about where you want to go to college, what you want to do in your life, which I think is some pretty valid questions. And they got to my son, which they thought right away, my son, because he's so academically smart, just way beyond where he is. But so they asked him, the professor asked him and stuff, and MIT and said, you know, you should, you know, you obviously really like that, you have a knack for programming. Well, he appears to have a knack for programming because I homeschooled him for 2 years, and that's primarily what we did. And, you know, he knows how to program shit. He knows programming language inside and out. And they said, you know, what are you thinking about doing? And he says, well, I'm not going to college. And this is kind of someone like that from this school, you know, you gotta understand that. I mean, I'm not bragging here or anything, or this is just, but this is a school like where all the Barcelona players take their kids here. It's very common for me to go up and pick up my daughter and see Neymar and the goalies and some other kids from the Barca team. I mean, and the lineup of Mercedes and fancy cars. I mean, it costs over $25,000. U.S. dollars per student, no matter whether they're 6 years old or 15, to take them to school here. But anyways, so when a student says they're not going to go to college, it's not that they can't afford it. So they're like, really, why would you want to do that? Why would you not want to do that? You have so much talent and stuff. And he says, well, I can come up with the ideas of the next robotics or spaceships or whatever I want to do. That's what I'm good at doing, is coming up with the ideas. I'll just hire the people that have already gone to MIT. I love that answer. But so anyways, that's kind of the way you want to be thinking about your business too, on that end of it. But you also want to be careful and kind of clean out all these, we have these incredible amount of messages that we get from the outside world, from professors. It's just ingrained in the system and nobody questions it. Go to school, get a good job, be secure. And to break away from that, you're going to get resistance and tension. So that's the first disruption you need to do mentally with yourself. Whether you're 13, 30, 60 years old, it doesn't matter. So you want to start questioning all the input that you have been giving your whole life, okay? It's hard to unprogram this stuff, it really is, because everybody in society is supporting it. It doesn't matter if you go to talk to your grandparents, you go to a restaurant, whatever, and you ask somebody, should I go to school or not? Should I go to college or not? 9 times out of 10, they're going to tell you to go to college, probably 10 times out of 10. But anyways, and I'm not, for all those people out there, I'm not against college. If if that's really what you want to do, and you know, you want to become a scientist, you want to, you know, study, you know, microbiology because you want to really change the world, and I don't mean changing the world by working for a pharmaceutical company. You want to, you know, become a doctor, a CPA, attorney, but God knows, at least in the U.S., we don't need any more attorneys. By the way, interesting fact, U.S. has 10 attorneys that graduate every year for every one engineer. Korea has the reverse. 10 engineers and scientists every year that graduate for every one lawyer. Guess who's the number one in medicine, science, and has the fastest internet technology in the entire world that hasn't been released yet to the entire world? It's only in Korea. Korea. Yeah, they're kicking ass. Anyways, so you want to really, this is, you know, this kind of approach to disruption. So you want to disrupt kind of the input that you're getting in. I'll speed up on here. I'm trying to ramble. So you want to disrupt the information that's coming into you on that. It's really important to do it, to question yourself. Don't just listen to me and think, oh, that sounds like right. No, I mean, really be present of it during the day. You want to start questioning on that so that you, so that the people that you spend your time around with have got to be giving you the right kind of input. If you can't find it, you need to find them. The other thing on here is that one thing on here that you absolutely have to be doing on this, I'm going to start pushing this a lot more because it's really changed my life on here, is that moving forward on here, lifelong learning is no longer a luxury. It's absolutely positively mandatory to surround yourself with positive, empowering, educational input, okay? This information that I'm sharing with you right now is a reflection both directly and then internalizing it and personalizing it in my own life and then sharing it with you. And it has an effect on me, and I hope I've passed that effect on, I'm passing that effect on to you too, and it's making a difference on here. So it's no longer a mantra. You need to start, you have to have a lifetime education. So, you know, which is another thing. When you look at the current education system, there's a lot of things wrong with it. But one of them that I really think is that where, when you're learning a trade, you know, the 4 years of college, and if you get a PhD, then you're adding probably another 4 more years on top of that. So 8 years, 8 years of just constantly learning. There is no evidence out there to suggest that that's the best way to learn that, okay? I would think a much better way to do it would be to break it up to more of a lifelong learning. Life and learn, life, learn, apply, life, learn, apply. Anyways, so you really want to ask yourself how you, this is another disruptor personally that you want to do. Now remember, you can't disrupt life and business out there, which changes everything, unless you first are a disruptor in your own personal life on that. So how do you approach problems and how do you react to them? Because being an entrepreneur, you're going to get a lot of problems. The thing is a lot of people just can't be entrepreneurs because they can't handle the barrage of random shit that comes up. Okay. I mean, for example, I've got a manufacturer actually in Tokyo, and I, for my Hong Kong account, I wired some money over there, and it was a personal name instead of a company name. So the personal name, I gave the abbreviation. I don't want to give it here because I don't want to reveal too much, but I gave the abbreviated name Tom instead of Thomas, But the same last name is correct, the account number, everything else is correct, the address. The bank won't accept it. But yet the bank in Tokyo won't release the funds either. So I have to contact, you know, I have to take time out on a busy day. So I've got to contact my Hong Kong bank. And they're just as worried about this stuff as other banks. And so they're like, okay, we have to send you a form. Can we send it by email? I said, great. Can I sign it and just send it right back by email? They said, nope. You got to send an original. I'm like, Jesus. So I got to send an original. I got to send an original. And then they got to send an original all the way to Hong Kong. I got to send it from Barcelona to Hong Kong. And then they got to personally send it with their signatures all the way to Tokyo before the vendor for a Shopify store that I've got can release the inventory. Well, this slows up everything. A lot of people can't deal with that kind of stuff. So what do you do with that? How do you want to start questioning yourself? How do you deal with stress? What's your emotional reaction to this kind of stuff? Do you feel frustrated and defeated? Okay. Or can you change the way you think so you can tackle the problem faster with more efficiency? For example, one person might get frustrated and think, oh, why me? Man, I'm the victim. What's so wrong with these stupid banks? Oh my God. Compared to someone else who might get frustrated, it's like, that kind of sucks. But it motivates them to find a solution on that. You see these two people on here and their end results will be different because of their mindsets. Okay. I hope that kind of sinks in. That's really important. So how you react to something, your neurons, okay, your neurons in your brain, if you start to train yourself here, how you react to stressful situations or any situations, and you start to train yourself to look for solutions and move forward to help you get it motivated rather than defeated in a victim role, it actually changes the neurons and the makeup in your brain. There's a lot of science behind this. So you actually think different. And more you do it, the more it just becomes natural on this end of it, the more dendrites you start to create in your brain to do this. So how you choose to think changes the way your brain processes information on that. So you can become a disruptor too, also in your time management, how you spend your time on this end of it. Because you and I and Richard Branson and, owner of Tesla, I forget his name right now, the owner of Tesla, who just woke up one day and decided he wants electric cars all around the world because it would be better for the world, and he wants a better online payment system, and he wants to be able to fly to the moon, and he just decides he wants to do it. Well, his neurons are hardwired a little bit different. He's not actually a different human being or race than you and I. He just thinks things a little bit differently on that end of it. So basically what I'm talking about here is what I wanted to do initially. I hope I didn't ramble too long and lose the whole thought train on this end of it, but introduce the thought of disruptors. You want to be a disruptor, but before you can be one, you have to be one in your own mindset, how you react to stress, how you manage time. Okay. We all have the same amount of time every day. We have to learn how to manage that better on this end. You want to be a disruptor in your own life, and that when you do that, things are going to change on here. How you react to stressful situations. You want to be a disruptor. You want to create the disruption in your own personal emotional life to make that happen. It's all about mindset here. And that this will cause you go from a limiting view of you and the world to a limitless view of you and the world. So this is kind of like when you do this, it's, when you go through this process that I'm talking about, I mean, really freaking do it, okay? It's kind of like going from the revolver to the sword. You can't go back anymore, okay? If somebody suddenly handed you the revolver after you've always had the sword and you've been badly on the field, now you can just pluck people off, boom, 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 boom. Are you going to go back and say, that revolver was pretty cool? And, I'm not dying, and I'm just plucking, fish. This is like fishing out of a barrel. This is easy. You're just going to give up that revival? No, you cannot go back anymore. That's a true disruptor. So let that kind of image sink in your mind so and motivate you to become a disruptor in the various areas of your mental life and that of it. How you react to stress. This is the big things for entrepreneurs. How you react to stress. It's a really big thing. If you can become a disruptor in that and not go, oh, poor me, da, da, da. Nope. You know, it sucks, but I'm kind of upset. I'm going to use that to motivate me to move forward. Because you're going to get a lot of practice to do that as being an entrepreneur, trust me. How you manage time. You got to master that. Okay, you have to master how you manage your freaking time. And I've talked about this before in other various videos that people are just kind of addicted to being distracted and stuff like this. So anyways, you do that, you're going to be like the revolver and the sword, which I started out here. And then once you have the revolver and you're up against everybody with the sword, you can't go back, right? It's impossible. That end of it. So kind of moving forward in your business world, you need to always be asking yourself on here, and you know, you need to be asking yourself and your company and stuff, are you a dinosaur or are you a disruptor? Is your business and your mindset, that's where it has to start on that, a disruptor or a dinosaur? See, look, the big dinosaurs on that end of it are always competing against the other big dinosaurs. And it reminds me of this scene here. It's not the best image in the world, but bear with me. Jurassic Park 3, where these guys are battling out the big dinosaurs. They're battling out. Meanwhile, these guys are trying to escape out of the car and get out. They've totally ignored who was in the car and the people around them because they're fighting with themselves on here. So the big dinosaurs will always be competing against other big dinosaurs, despite, and they're not going to notice the underfunded, small, smart-minded business disruptors. So on that end of it. So I think of this kind of situation and it reminds me of a fact. And I'll give you some examples here and then we'll sum it up here in 60 seconds. No matter what business you're in, and you're all in business, right? No matter what business you're in, there's always going to be disruptions in it. That's a fact. And the idea is you got to constantly be looking around you. What's the disruptor going on? You don't even need to be the one. You just need to be around it and understand what's going on because there's huge value fallout. And you got to make enough adjustment to belong into that fallout. I hope that makes sense. But if you don't do it and you're like these two dinosaurs here fighting and they're missing out on their food there in the car, it reminds me of places like Sears, Blockbusters, Motorola, Polaroid. And my favorite, because I used to go there all the time and buy Kiss records, Tower records on that end of it. So disruptor or dinosaur, there's no middle ground, folks. It's one or the other. Okay. I always kind of feel like I ran on those too long, but who cares? Until we get our complaint in customer service, I'm not going to do it. Although I have gotten a customer some complaints in the support desk about some foul language that I use on these, and I'm going to do my best to kind of clean it up. Sometimes I get a little bit emotional, and I might use some language that I probably shouldn't, and it's probably better off. I mean, the truth of the matter is that when you start using, you know, words that you probably wouldn't use in front of your kids, at least it's true for me when I use those, it usually means I'm just being a little too lazy with my language abilities and I can't come up with a better way to describe it. So I agree, should clean it up. Anyways, we got some house cleaning and we'll move right into questions and answers. Let me just check the... I always get kind of nervous at this point. It's like my whole thing here. Don't worry about the language. Okay. Love the passion, the mindset. Okay. Not being lazy. Foul language. Keep it real. Okay. So we got a lot of people like the foul language on this end of it. I would like the ability to be able to share these with my kids, so I'm going to try to keep it clean. Anyways, the message will still be the same. And I'll keep the emotion there, too. How about that? To compromise. Okay, so a little bit of housekeeping here. And so I want to talk a little bit about Vegas. I've run events before, but never quite like this. And I was really shocked by the reaction in a positive way. So I first thought, you know what? I'll do the kind of traditional, what everyone else does out there, would, you know, kind of rent a hall out at a hotel, and everybody stays in the hotel, and you get up and you mingle your way down. And I thought, you know what? I want it to be different. It doesn't feel kind of cozy to me. And then I was looking at the number of members that are in the Facebook group, and I was thinking, you know what? People are busy. They're all over the place. It probably won't be that much percentage, because the truth of the matter is that normally, if you've got 1,000, you know, active people, and you've got an event that you're going to hold on, normally about maybe 1-2% are going to actually buy a plane ticket, travel out. I mean, it's a huge thing to do, right? So it's kind of based off of that. So I thought, okay, I want to do something more personal, kind of more cozy, because the best kind of mastermind type of events I've ever personally been to are not the ones where I'm at a big, huge kind of, you know, sanitary hotel. I can't stand hotels, by the way. Like sanitary hotel, and I'm in a room that someone obviously smoked in, and they put too much perfume and stuff in there. To try to mask the smell. But anyways, and although I've met some I met some life-changing people at those events, and I would highly recommend to go, I was like, let's take it up a notch higher. What's the best kind of event I've ever been to? And one where I felt like I had like the most now what people always say about events is meeting the people at the event and creating those bonds is the most important thing. And I understand if you've been to an event where there's 1,000 people, that may or may not happen. It definitely has the potential to happen, or may or may not. But I attended an event. It was the Marketing Mansion event. Anyways, it was held by a really good friend of mine, and he asked me to do the opening guest speech there. And it was very small, and they had rented out this huge house. It happened to be in Vegas, and it was a 3-day thing, and everybody stayed there and ate there, and they did everything there. And by the end of the third day, even though I was a guest there, I really made some friends that I'm still friends with today. And it was good. I really liked it. It wasn't like a regular big old event. So I thought, given the number of people and stuff, I'd kind of rather do that. So I went out and I looked for the biggest place I could find in Vegas, because I took a poll and most people were like raising their hand for Vegas. So I thought, okay, that's cool. Anyways, we sold out in like literally a couple of hours, every single room, even my room. Someone came in and said, hey, I just canceled my flight with my family to Disneyland to come out with this kind of stuff. And we'd already sold out, and the only room was left was mine. So by the way, you got my room. Not a big deal. Anyways, I think it's going to be a really special event. And for those of you who got in, I truly believe it's going to be one of these things where you're going to go, and you're going to spend in a big old house. You're going to spend time with people, both at a structured event. It's going to be very different than what you think it's going to be. Trust me. So just have no expectations and just an open mind is the best way to go. Because you're going to be introduced to my world. And it's going to be good, because there's other events I've attended like this in Singapore, and these are out of the whole kind of arena that a lot of you came from here and in Bangkok. And what I enjoy most about going to these events for me is not the speaking, not the people who speak, but because at the events, I know I get to team up and hang out with the other people that I got to before. And we all have like these business kind of relations together and stuff. So anyways, I think that's the most, one of the most important things you can gain out of these. And this environment is going to be that. There's a maximum, how many people do we have that's actually staying? Now the place can fit 16, but we have 12, but we have 14 in there. Okay, 14. So I'm capping what they can, how many people can stay in there at 14. I just don't want to get too crowded. The maximum number of people total during the event, and the event can handle this, the place is just 20, and that's it. And there's still a couple of places available for people who can either get a hotel. There's one just literally 10-minute walk, very short walk. Just walk straight down the street, and then our kind of mansion place is there. And there's six of those available left. It just means you have to stay away from the mansion, but you can stay with us all day long and all that kind of stuff. So you still aren't getting an incredible amount of benefit from it. So that's what's going on there. Depending, and I'll have different reactions when it's done. The very last day, which is when the majority of people will be leaving, the last day, I'll be holding a private intensive mastermind that will last an entire year. I was actually very surprised how quickly those just sold up. And there's two spots of those available. It's going to be very close niche. We will meet, be very intensive, but I think the Friday, just meet and greet, everybody get together, have a good time. And then on Saturday and Sunday, I purposely set Saturday at 10 a.m. to start and Sunday at 11. I just know that other events that I've attended, I was like, I just wish those people would have done that. Only because there's different time zone changes. And if you're in Vegas, there's probably going to be some people going out and drink. You want a little bit of time to sleep in, and you want to be kind of fully aware when you come at the event. So that's the reason I changed the events in it. So I'm being a disruptor in that sense. And I've got a lot of friends, a lot of really cool, I've been very fortunate and blessed to have a lot of really cool friends. There's gonna be a lot of, we don't have enough time for it in this, but there'll be some really interesting people that are going to come and share some real value with you. And this is a no pitch session. There's no one's here to sell you Jack. So it's going to be really good. The two spots that we have left for the private mastermind, that's an entire year process. We're going to meet twice live, four times, for 4 to 6 hours on video Skype. And then optional, you can come hang out with me. I know not everybody has the means or the time to do that, but that's why I put optional. Optional, you have the time to come out and hang out, and we can analyze your business and add some value and stuff like that. And I'll be in Tokyo. Korea, which is amazing, and Hong Kong. And if you are in the area and you've joined that mastermind group, and when I'm in Hong Kong, you'll be there. Might be a good time if it's part of your business strategy and we talk about it. Might be a good time to open up a Hong Kong account there. Hong Kong business, tremendous bank savings. I don't know if any of you know this, when you get the receipt or anything, for me, all my stuff is from Hong Kong. What else? In Tokyo, what I'm doing right now is part of my kids' education. My 11-year-old daughter, my 13-year-old boy, we've opened up a Shopify store. Now, I'm not doing the work. I'm just being like a teacher. They're already profitable with it. So by the time we reach Tokyo, which is going to be the summer, the beginning of September, I've already booked them for it. They don't know this yet. I've already booked them for it. They're going to be speaking at an event and talking about their Shopify experience. and stuff. And so you can meet in Tokyo with us. Tokyo is an amazing place, by the way. And that, so that's all part of that kind of mastermind stuff. And there'll be a separate group for that. Some of the best changes I've ever made in my life have been through mastermind groups. I just, if you can afford it, if you feel like you're in the place to do it, trust me, I don't think you're going to find a better group of people that are going to really care and experiences that you have. So, and then the other things that we're going to be looking at in the mastermind group is in the intensive mastermind group is not only paper call offline, how to do that, and just really drilling deep, but also looking at other ways without distracting from your kind of main focus, is other ways to start building out sources of income. You should always diversify on that end of it. I've personally diversified. I've got an Amazon store, very successful. I got Shopify, I got a drop shipment. And I'm always, I'm in the marketplace, I'm always looking to buy. There's actually a big marketplace to buy Amazon stores and stuff like that. But anyways, so that's what the mastermind is event. Two spots left for that. I just want to keep it close and personal. And I've got a good friend of mine that's going to come in and talk about how he was extremely successful in his offline world with businesses. And he actually attended my very first event. It was a two-day intensive event. This was in San Diego years ago. We've kept in touch since then. He still has a very successful offline business, but he's then diversified into Amazon, and we've actually teamed up. And he's going to come kind of talk about that experience, about how to kind of manage those two things. That's not at the regular event. I apologize for that. That's for the Super Masterminds group on that end of it. And we've got some other really special guests coming too. Again, not to pitch. I've got some. I kind of get a sense from the group too that not everybody, but the majority, there's a lot of technical information, both provided by me and the people bring to the group, but there's not this sense of business and how to really run a business. There's a lot of technical stuff, and I think it's out of balance. So I'm inviting people to come in and talk about how they've kind of evolved and the growing pains they've gone to run successful businesses. And those same growing pains are the same for everybody, whether it's online or whether it's running brick and mortar. I have some pretty cool friends, so there'll be some good stuff there. Okay, so enough of the Vegas stuff, enough of Mastermind. Site structure. It's just some things that I've noticed when I'm looking at support tickets. Let me take a drink of water here. Hang on 1 second. Some things I've noticed about site structure that there might be a little bit of confusion. So I want to talk about that for just a little bit. Let's actually go online and see if we actually find some live examples and we kind of pick those apart. So let me give my... This is not pre-planned, so this might take a DUI. Yeah, attorney San Diego, that's a good one. Okay, so let's take a look at some of these structures on here. And the site structure that some students are coming in, and I need to do a better job. I'm going back in the course, and I think reiterating this from different angles. So I will do that, so I take responsibility for that. But let's take a look at some of these. Here we go, right here. So what I'm looking for is a site that's a more national, a master site, and this is it. This is one right here. The reason these guys are at the bottom, I can tell you right now, is because they see this little period there. They made it a subdomain or pre-subdomain. I don't know what you call it, and that's why they're down here. Had they just made this one whole site instead and just put doicentral.com/San Diego, I guarantee you they'd be up at number one. So. Let's just take a look at how they have their site structured. So this is an example of something you do not want to structure your site like. Um, So we're not looking at site design on here. We're looking at site structure. Probably not the best way to do that. So what I'm going to do instead is I'm just going to take this and we'll just actually look at the site structure itself. Because I totally get that. People are like, all right, site structure, how do you do that? I had questions for that for years. I was like, it was a real pain point. I paste that in and then get rid of this stuff. So what am I doing right now? I'm doing the same process you would do if you wanted to find out whether your pages, let's see here. I'm still trying to figure out my new computer. Keyboards are slightly off, and I'm such a creature of habit, it's horrible. Okay, so right here. So first of all, I mean, notice how many pages I got. You see that? 5,130 pages. There are a lot of cities. I'm going to guess probably only California, but let's take a look at it. So this is San Diego. That's it. San Diego on here. Escondido, which is just a suburb of San Diego. So they've got those going out. Man, the way they structure this is kind of funny, though. DOI Central offices, San Diego. Okay, cool. So I can guarantee you that attorneys who are running offices, and they've got multiple offices, which is what these guys have. So what they're usually doing is they're hiring kids fresh out of college. And they like want to go work for a big top 10 firm, and that's what this one is. So they basically pay them peanuts to come work for them, and they generate millions and millions of dollars every month. Anyways, so you can see like this is like DOI Central, which is something they probably paid dearly for that domain. And then what they're using here is offices/San Diego. Yucky. This one should be ranking in San Diego, but which one was ranking in San Diego? This one. I'm totally confused. I hope I can find you a better example. Look at, and they got San Diego.central. Oh boy. This is scary. Okay. Anyways, if I just go a couple more pages, I think you'll see they're in like all up and down California, I'm sure. I could have looked at their locations, but they've got a lot of stuff going on here. That was a messy example. Let me see if I can find locations on here, and we can kind of see what else they did. Okay, so here they go. San Diego Courts, that's not it. In terms of use, sitemap. Can you see how messy? Can you see if I found this somewhere and I want to find one in some other city, how hard it is to do? And how our site structure is so much more friendly. Holy smokes. Okay, that's horrible. Let me do another one. Pest Control San Diego. And hopefully what I'm looking for is like more of a kind of a franchise type thing. Yeah, I know I can't spell. It's okay. It's the internet's fault. No. Lloyd's Pest Control. Maybe. Oh, why do they put cities? You don't want to put cities here. Why? Look, let me ask you this one. In site structure, and you have this, why would you not want to put, why do you put cities there as a category? Just put the city name. It's already obvious, right? It's not like you put LloydPestControl.com/California/cities/San Diego. Okay, here's a good locations. Ah, okay. Oh, I was hoping I could find a good example. I guess to be honest with you, I was doing a lot of other things before the webinar, so I didn't have time to put something together, for example, on this. Okay, so they're not doing such a bad job here. So what they've got here, right, is they've got their Clark Pest locations, San Diego. So pretty cool. And I bet if I type in San Diego, I think I did. Yeah, they're ranking right up there. So let's check them out somewhere else. And okay, forget it. Let me just do this instead. I'm getting annoyed with these people. Okay, I apologize for this. Let me just open this up just real quickly. And okay, so basically this, there are different ways to do this, and there's no like absolute correct way or not, okay? But so this is if you're doing just, you have one homepage, so your one homepage is just whatever your niche is, and that one homepage is going to be ranking in every city. You don't have it divided up into two or three pages of keywords. So is this going to be, I'm just going to put site, .com, and then after that, I'm just going to put the city name. Okay, so I'm just going to put the city name, Houston. Okay, so that's it. And then the next city that I open up in, and it's going to be plumbing, it's going to be electrician, whatever, site, .com/Austin, okay? And you can just go on, because look, there's not going to be another Houston somewhere else, right? I mean, yes, there is a Paris, Texas, but you're probably not going to be in Paris, okay? France. So this is fine to do it this way, okay? So that's if you have one homepage. If you have just one homepage, there's no reason to go site .com/TX/ Houston. You can. It's not that big of a deal. It's not going to affect your SEO either way. I'm always in favor of creating the shortest, non-spammy URL possible. And if you just have that one rule in mind, how can I create the shortest, non-spammy URL possible? So let me just show you an example of what you not want to do. site.com/ plumbers Houston. No, don't do that. Okay. Google don't like that. Right. And certainly don't do that and then do, right? Because that just creates too long. Right? That's like too wrong, too long. Too long, too wrong, too long, too wrong, and too spammy. Okay, you got it? So let's say that you now, the only way you could go wrong with this stuff on here is if you went too spammy. It's the only way you could go wrong. If you put cities in, I don't know why you'd put city in, but category city, but that's crazy. That's usually not a WordPress programmer, but a HTML programmer. Alrighty, so let's say you have multiple cities in the same niche. So I always have to be careful about giving examples here, because sometimes I give examples and I don't mean to, and it's someone else's niche, and then I get this huge emotional support, and I get it, because you're working really hard, so I'm not putting you down, but I get this, or people down. I get this huge emotional support desk questions back saying, hey, you mentioned my niche on the coaching call yesterday. Now everyone's going to go for it. I'm ruined. No, it's not it. See, the thing is this. Is that even if someone knew your niche or I mentioned a niche, it takes a hell of a lot of work. Okay, I just swore, and I told myself I wasn't going to do that. So it's going to take a heck of a lot of work to do a niche. It takes not days, not one, not two, not five, 365 days a year, every year, to really make this thing work, okay? When you can make these things work and you're committed to it, and the amount of commitment it takes, and it takes a lot of commitment. Don't take this as a negative thing. Remember what I talked about earlier about being a disruptor. You want to change your mental thinking about this. Is this a problem or a solution that gets you excited and motivated? And that's what this should be, because most people won't become the disruptor in their own emotional life. And they will certainly will not take this much action. So even if I mentioned a niche and you think, oh my God, now everyone's going to do this niche. How much work does it take to get that niche to rank in 30, 40, 50 cities? And how long do you think that would take to complete that 50 cities ranking page one above the fold? A long time and a lot of work, okay? And the truth of the matter is, unfortunately, is a lot of people are just not willing to do that. Or they lose focus, or they're like, oh, this is too much work. Whew, I'm tired. Oh, shiny object, I'm off. Bye-bye. Okay, I've got a video that I was doing a niacin detox. And so when you do niacin, it brings blood to your skin. So my face is all red. And I was doing it right on my deck, right outside my office right here. And I was talking about this exact topic, which is people which we all do this, and I'm guilty of it too. And I'm way guilty of this for the majority of my life, is we're just used to distractions. And it's like, it's very hard for people to stay focused these days. It's even harder to stay focused the more modern that we get. And we have all these little distractions. It's like, oh, geez, man, work is hard. Oh, man, this is painful. I got to concentrate. Better check Facebook. Oh, I got a little message. And you get that little endorphin high. It's like, oh, that's what I was looking for. Oh, whew. Good. Okay, then back to work. Oh, got a Twitter comment. Emotional high. No, turn all those darn things off. And sorry. All those things off in that. I mean, anyway, okay, so back to this. So let's say you got multiple sites. And in module one, the last two modules, watch them and rewatch them. You step away from the data, and Google will tell you in your particular niche with your keywords whether you can rank one page for all your keywords or not. And if you can't, then you got to create two keywords. It's kind of like two niches in one city. And if it's kind of blended together, you kind of go through the process and like, well, half the sites approximately can rank one page for both of these group of keywords. And the other half on page one specializes and they just do one. If I was confronted with that, I would do the specialization. Let me give an example in plumbing. For example, you've got heating and cooling havoc. So, you know, it's basically your cooling system, right? Cooling and heating system. And then you got kind of general plumbing type stuff. There's a lot of websites in that niche that can get away with ranking one page in Houston for both of those group of keywords. And then you'll also find on there that there's a group that will only rank for just heating and stuff. Some for just heating and cooling combined, some for just cooling, some for just heating. You need to kind of break that up. And when you do, if you find at least half that specialize and just do a page not on just heating, and the other half on just cooling, and the other half is doing heating and cooling, don't take the lazy route and go just heating and cooling on one page. At the end of the day, I promise you this. Every day, the internet world gets more and more competitive. It's just a fact. And Google likes specialization. So Google will reward you if someone types in, just think about this. Someone types in, air conditioning repair, blah, blah, blah. Well, right now, the best choices that Google can give you, based on all kinds of algorithm mumbo jumbo, is half of the sites are a combination of the front page will give you both about heating and about air conditioning, but you were worried about fixing your air conditioner. But they also fix air conditioning and heating, so it's kind of okay. And some of the other search results they'll give the end user will be only about fixing your air conditioning. Over time, my prediction is that Google will favor the sites that are really well done and specialized, so that when someone types in, I need air conditioning repair, and if your site is well done and it's and your page is only about air conditioning and stuff and repair and cooling and blah, 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 and checkups, they're probably going to give you as the best choice versus someone who talks about that and the heating in the wintertime. Does that make sense? So that's when you want to do two pages. I made a whole 30-minute video rambling about an example, so check that out. So if that's you, then this is what your site structure is going to look like. Okay, so I understand how many years this took me to figure out. Oh boy. Okay, so site dot, I'm just going to use the same old example here. Forward, I'm going to do, I'm not in the plumbing it, so if my terms that I'm using are not exact, don't come down on me hard. Just understand the overall concept, and that's what's important. So I'm going to do air conditioning. I'm just going to abbreviate for this on here. And then my same site, whoops, okay, so I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do, Dallas. And I cannot type Dallas air conditioning. So it's going to be Dallas air conditioning. And then my same site, I'm going to do site / Dallas. Yes, I realize I removed that. I've actually got my mic in the way, so I can't see that well. / heating. It could be heating repair, air conditioning repair, whatever. So that's the way you're going to set that up. And that's the way I would, okay? Could you put another category of state in there? Yeah, you could. But I'm for the shorter URLs. And how many Dallases are there in the United States? I know there's going to be somebody that's going to come back with and say, you know, hey, there's a Dallas here and there, but you know the population is like 30,000, so it doesn't matter. There's not any Dallases out there that have significant populations that you need to include the state. Okay, so that's how I would do that. If you want to put in a two-letter thing for the state, go ahead. It's not going to make that big of a difference. So I hope that kind of makes sense. There's not like an absolute right way to do it. The only absolute wrong way to do it, in my opinion, is just staying away from spammy stuff. Don't put like, you know, heating and cooling Houston or something like that. Google's made it very clear. Hold on. That they want branding names. They've got video recordings of this in San Jose. Used to have an office, by the way, right across the street from Google in San Jose. So convenient because the airport was right there too. Anyways, and so it's not that big of a deal if you want to put like a state or something in there. I'm always for the shorter, but if you like to be, you know, you like kind of want to categorize everything and stuff, and that's so your mind works, that's okay. But just don't add I would add just the city, and I would keep your root URL as the brand name, which hopefully doesn't have, you know, a whole bunch of keywords in it. Okay. Hope that makes sense. Let me move on here and get into questions and answers, which is actually the most enjoyable part of doing these mastermind strike structure. Okay, backlink velocity. I want to cover backlink velocity. And actually, let me just do it with a random example. Hopefully, I can come up with some better ones than I just did. Look, people always ask me, how quickly do we add backlinks? You know, do I add, you know, 5 or 6 or 10 a month, you know, and this kind of stuff. So it's really important to understand some core concepts I'm going to share with you. And with the help of some really talented people on my staff, we've got over 3,000 sites ranking above the fold in the top 5 on page 1 for our keywords. So please listen to what I have to say to you. I'm not going to tell you some mumbo jumbo magic. This is just some basic business stuff, but you got to do it. But really what I'm trying to do when I share with you, so the fact of the matter, I just realized it right now, the fact of the matter is that the reason I have to share this with you is because there's so much guru SEO crap out there that I have to be a disruptor and take you away from that, because you're in the mindset of you got to go to college to get a good thing. You got to do this for SEO to rank number one. And I got to come in and tell you, no, it's not the way it goes. Okay. I hope that makes sense. I don't even know if anyone's on the call still. Yes, there are. I always kind of wonder that. I'll tell you what's kind of interesting. I used to actually run a radio station. I had my own radio show. I remember the first time I went in. It was going to be my first record. First time ever on the radio. I was like, oh, I was so nervous. I woke up that morning and I was like scared. I was so scared I couldn't eat breakfast. And I wasn't fasting at the time, so that was like a big deal. I couldn't eat breakfast. I could barely drink coffee. I was so worried. And my show wasn't until 6 p.m. Okay. And I was like writing my notes down frantically that I was going to be talking about. And I was like going over them. And I was nervous as heck, scared out of my britches. And then I remember driving down there, and it was a long ways away. I was in Gilbert, Arizona at the time, and I had to drive down to the center of Phoenix, Arizona. And this was an AM station, so it was not just in, it was a very popular one. It wasn't just in Arizona, it was national. And I was like, whoa, shit. God, I just did it again. Darn it. Poopy. And I remember driving down, and there was traffic because the show started at 6. I needed to be there early, so I started driving down at 4:30. I'm hitting traffic, blah, blah, blah. And I get there, and I actually get there early, and I'm out in the parking lot, and I'm like too early to like show up because it looks stupid. You know what I mean? It's like, oh, geez, the guy's first day on the show, and you're like 35 minutes early. So I didn't want to do that. So I just stayed out in the parking lot and like walked around, and I had this whole thing of notes in my hand I was going through. And I was doing like breathing exercises, and I was like doing like, you can do things this is actually really works too, by the way. If you're ever nervous or stuff, if you do breathing exercises and you like, breathe in, and you're like, but you breathe in from the bottom of your stomach, and you imagine it like a balloon expanding from the bottom of your stomach all the way up into your lungs. Just, and then you hold it for 10 seconds, and then you release it for 10 seconds. And you do that 3 times. It really calms you down. Try it sometime. It's just like, it's 30 seconds of your life. It calms you down. And so I did that, and I walked around, and I was like, okay. And I just got exhausted. I was like, I'm doing that for like 15 minutes. I'm like, I'm like over prepared. If I do any more, I'm going to burn myself out. And then I walked in there, and it was like, it was the first time I'd been in a radio station. And when you walk in the radio station, it's like, there's all these celebrity images with their signatures on the wall. So there's like Dave Ramsey, and I don't know, a whole bunch of other people I can't even remember. I've never been good at remembering celebrity names because, frankly, I don't pay attention. But there's a whole lot of people up on the wall that were like all famous and their signatures. And I'm going like, oh my goodness, what am I doing here? Do I belong here? I got to get out. I'm like starting to panic. And then the engineer who's going to, and the engineer like lets you know when there's like 10 seconds before the commercial and like cuts it off and then plays the commercial. So the engineer comes out and says, Mr. Winters, we're ready to start. Let's come on in. So I follow him in, and then I open up this like wooden door, and I close it, and I look behind, and the wooden door's got all this like little sound padding on it. It's got the little ruffles on it, if you know what that looks like. And the whole room is like padded. It's like the floor is like this 1980s shag carpet, and they got a mic in front of me, and then there's a glass window, and the engineer's in there, and he's like, you know, he like goes over the loudspeakers and talks to me. He says, hey, do you know how to speak on the mic? Make sure that when you're on the mic and you're like turning your head, that you always keep 2 inches from it, okay? If you turn to the left or the right, just always keep 2 inches from it. I'm like, okay. And he says, just always make sure you keep your eyes up at me, and I'll direct you with my fingers. Count them, okay. And then there's like a little sign on the door, like recording on, off, all that kind of stuff. And he started, and it was me in a one-hour show. I'm like all by myself. I got to talk for a whole hour, right? And then there was 1, 2, 3, 4. It's 4 commercial breaks on that end of it. So basically at the quarter of the hour, bottom, middle, and almost at the top, and then you wrap up for 2 minutes at the end. That's why I got to watch the engineer. Remember how absolutely freaking terrified I was. I don't even have my slides up here. Let me work them up. So I got through it, and I was okay. Okay. And when you're working through this stuff, whether it's for, you know, your business, everybody. Here's the main point. I babbled on like I do too long. Here's the main point. We're all going to cross or have the this is the key word, opportunity to get out of our comfort zone. And I would encourage each and every one of you at every single opportunity in your lives to step out of your comfort zone. It will be scary. But can you guess how good I felt when that was done? I mean, I don't mean because it was done, like a, oh, surgery's done, it's a relief. I mean, do you realize how good I felt about myself when I was done? I felt really good. So, and all growth, personal growth, takes place outside of your comfort zone. So with any opportunity you get, for God's sakes, raise your hand and say, I volunteer, I'll do it. And no matter how, you know, poop scared you are, I almost said the other word, S-I-H-T. No matter how poop scared you are, go for it. Because however long it takes, 30, 60 minutes, when you get done with it, you will feel like a new person. Okay, so let me go back here. I think I did that site structure. Oh, backlink velocity. Ah, the technical stuff. I think I want to give an example on this. So let me just run through that. I apologize. So this is kind of important about backlink velocity because people act like, in backlink velocity means how the velocity is speed, right? So the speed or the velocity at which you have backlinks. And obviously, if you're a CallZoom member, then you know we provide you with the Web 2.0s, and we'll have the domains too. Yeah, and you can provide some really good backlinks. We have the backlink exchange. And so you have some incredible opportunities. So how fast or how slow should you do it? Well, that all depends on your specific niche. And let me show you an example on here. Let me just pick one here. I'm going to do a different one here. I'm going to do San Diego. Oh, I can't think of anything else. So I'm just going to go towing. Let's see what comes up here. So my IP address is a little bit different, right? So it's not going to... Look, I messed that up. I'm pest control still. dumb. Google's not perfect either. Okay. So depending on where you are, this one's probably ranking number one. So let's go ahead and analyze this. Let's say this was your niche, you're like into towing and you're gonna start in San Diego. So how do you determine? And yes, my internet is running really slow. Look at that roll. So as, hurry the freak up. My kids must be watching a lot of downloadable stream videos, which they should be in sleep because it's 10:21 my time. So while that's going on, let me pull up Majestica, and as members, you obviously will send you all the reports you want for these, because we want you to succeed. Very important. Oh boy, I'm already logged in. Okay, good. Okay, so that's not pulling up here. So, there we go. Okay, so these buckaroonos on here are ranking basically number one. Probably. I'm not an IP address there, so it's going to be close. Before we get to the backlinking structure and talk about backlinking velocity, it reminds me of another thing. When students are going through module one, and I need to change the instruction on this, because I do cover it in the last two videos, but it needs to be covered a little bit earlier. You need to step out of the data. And that's the numbers data, the keyword ranking tools, you know, all that kind of stuff. How many searches per month, the keyword. Once you got all that stuff figured out, you need to step out of that stuff and like look in Google and see what's ranking. So I'm going to look at this site. And this site is either, you know, and look, I'm from a Spain IP address, so it's going to be a little bit different than everyone else, but probably ranking pretty high up there. Let's take a look at this site, because you want to start studying these sites. You got to be a curious George on here. You got to study these sites. And let's just take a look at it and see how they're doing. Okay. So Mission Valley Towing, TowStar on here, Community Services. So right there, they've kind of filled up some information that, quite frankly, a busy customer doesn't give a crap. I meant poo-poo. Okay, so... So what you want to do at this point is I think there's a much smarter strategy at this point right here when someone logs in is to put the steps in here like we instruct to. Step one, do this. Call us. Step two, we'll return your call. Step three, we'll pick you up and you get home safe. Something like that. It's particularly towing, is a very specific problem-solving niche. When people come on your site, they want to know their problem is going to be solved. They're only calling because their car doesn't work. And if their car doesn't work, they are stuck. They got a problem. So that's what you want to address. Is this site addressing that? Maybe. No way. Now, this is kind of confusing. What is all this? What's this? Bunch of towing mumbo jumbo. Understand, I am on the freeway, or my car is stuck in my driveway and I can't get to where I want to get. It's not answering my question, my pain question, right? That's it? Are you joking me? Okay. Absolutely, positively, horrible sight. So let's go ahead and copy these jokers and see where they're ranking on here. I know where they're ranking. They're at least above the fold. Let's see why they're ranking. And yeah, look at that. Check it out. So I'm going to go right to their Discord domain. It's actually a little bit more accurate, but not much. So Mission Valley Towing. What are we did this in San Francisco or San Diego? Holy crows. Man. Okay. Check it out. Trust Flow Zero. So you already know you can get unlimited number under our terms and conditions, right? Unlimited number of trust flows of 10s and above of Web 2.0s. Okay. For your own personal and for group use to do link exchanges. How fast do you think you could kick these guys' bums? I was about to say the A word, by the way. I stopped myself. How quickly could you kick their bums? Assuming these guys are on, you know, at least the top three that are above the fold. Yeah, you could. They got no trust flow. Are you kidding me? So I want to talk about link velocity. So then that means we come to backlinks. You can almost come to this and just do one of our, you could do one of our Web 2.0s that we give to you as just part of being a member. Set it up like we instruct you to do. Maybe, if you need it. You know, because we're going to give you at least a 10, if not a 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17 trust flow. Okay, and they got zero, and they're ranking up at the top. And let's look at their backlink structure. That's a no follow. What? No follow, no follow, no follow. That's all they got is no follow stuff. Junk. And this is a Cindy of San Diego. I'm telling you, folks, there's so many opportunities out there. It's unbelievable. Anyways, so we look at this link velocity. What do they have for links? 5. They're all no follow. And let's assume this. Let's just assume that this one's ranking number 1, for example, okay? For my IP address, let's just assume that it is. If your number 1 person is ranking number 1, and they got a trust flow of 0. By the way, they didn't just have a trust flow of 0. They had a trust flow of 0. This is really important, too. Go to the summary. Come on. You know what I'm thinking right now? My internet's kind of slow. One of my kids is late night watching movies in bed. I guarantee it. But I'm not going to break away to bust their chops. Trust flow of 0 and a citation of 12. You know what that screams? Spam. Spammy, low quality links. When you have your trust flow and your citation wants to be really close to each other. So if you got a trust flow of 10 and a citation of 15, it's okay. You got a trust flow of 10 and you got a citation of 8, it's okay. You got a trust flow of 10 and a citation of 30, busted, you're a spammer, okay? Just like this. Trust flow is 0. Citation of 12. Busted. Okay? You could dominate this freaking market on here. And let me just go on here because that's why. So let me just show you something, how freaking powerful this is. So I'm going to go. Can't type because I got this new mic in front of me. I'm not used to it. Okay, so what I'm going to type into here, or get into if it will let me, is a account I do not use for Google AdWords. A keyword planner, that's what I want. Hang on one sec. I'm going to show you something just right here. It's going to kind of blow you away. Am I in here? Problem is, if you automate your business too much, you won't know how to do your business. Let me just do it this way. Bear with me, folks. And so I got this new computer with a smaller keyboard. I thought, oh, it'd be really cool. I'm gonna freaking buy another one. It's ridiculous. Hang on, just bear with me, please, because what I'm gonna about to show you is really, really important. Oh my goodness. Just let me in and do this, please. Google, I'm already signed into you. Don't let me run through a bunch of hoops. I'm too tired right now. It's my bedtime. Oh, jeez. I'm not even using IPs and they're asking me for this. But they gave me an easy one, right? Normally, everyone's so hard. Oh, they can't even. Okay, so G-A-M-U-L. Okay, you're all watching this, right? P A. What the heck is that? N I I. Oh man, N Y A B. I don't know. Okay, so this is easier, right? T O. R-O-L-D-E-N. It was smart enough to give me an easier one for big dummies. Oh, geez, this is crazy. After this, I'm done. Because who cannot do that? R-E-S-O. Okay. I'm not the best typer in the world. Okay, so maybe it's, I should take responsibility for that, right? S O I N G. I'm going to get it correct this time. Oh my God. This is the last time I'm doing it. I'm done. M I N U C T I. That's insane, right? That's the only thing. Forget it. I'm done. Okay. So backlink velocity. Contact our support desk, and then from there, your city that you're in, request give us the three URLs that are the top three URLs that you want to compete against in your niche, and we'll give you the backlink structure, and it will give you an idea. So, for example, if you got a site that has got 20 backlinks, it's probably not a good idea to be, delivering 20 backlinks in the first month. Is that right? That doesn't make sense, even with doing the crowdsourcing. But if you've got a site like the one I was trying to show you there with the towing, they have no trust flow. I think they had like 12 backlinks in the past year or so. So probably an okay idea to do like maybe one or two. Maybe rotate one in the first month, two in the next, one in the month after that. Backlinks, and then your backlinks are obviously going to have a higher trust flow than theirs. You see how that works? So there is no absolute formula. It depends on your niche. Hence, we provide the Majestica. Alrighty, so I waste enough time with that. And wasn't that kind of weird? It was seriously weird how Google did that to me. It's like they just wanted to play with me. So this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to go on to the bottom and work my way. Well, yeah, a little bit different. Site. Yeah, got it. Okay, yeah, I can't type. Okay, question on here. All right, that's a decent question. So what I'm going to do here is I'm just going to copy and paste his questions so that people who watch this can look on the slides. I don't know why it's doing that. So let me go into another one on here. Let me just start over here. Question. Oh, I feel like an idiot. What the heck is going on? Okay, let me do it this way. Sorry about that. Okay, so we got two good questions here. Get them set up. And we get rock and roll. So let me go ahead and paste them in. That's how it's going to work then for now. Okay. Apologize. New computer. Just going to work my way around it. Question one here. Concerning competition. When you look at the top three competitors in a city, okay, top three competitors in a city, I got it. How do you evaluate them? Question mark. Trust flow, 10, and referring domains, 30. What I try to do in the course is this, is I want to give everybody the opportunity to succeed as quickly and easily as possible. So what that means is that if the trust flow is a 10 or less, it's kind of a rough guideline I give. And the reason I give that guideline should be fairly obvious. Is that I know that my team can scrape enough W2.0 properties for you and just regular old domains that you pay for the domain and the hosting of a trust flow 10 or above. So if you are getting 10 and above and the group is getting 10 or above trust flow and you're doing link exchange, you're doing your own links back to your site and you're getting link exchanges within the group, I know you're going to kill it. And that towing site in San Diego, are you kidding me? I was really wishing I could show the number of searches in San Diego because I guarantee it's going to be, if you type in like towing plus towing San Diego, there's a whole lot of others, flatbed towing, motorcycle towing and stuff, but just those two main ones in the beginning, you're going to get at least 600-700 searches per month. That's going to equate to heck of a lot of searches. And the one that was ranking probably close to number one, or at least in the top three or four, because I'm in a different IP address, it had zero trust flow. So you take our Web 2.0s that we give you for free as a main member, you do the link exchange within a group, you're going to crush it. I hope you realize that really fast. Okay, so that's what we do there. But as far as the trust flow of a 10 or less and the referring domains of a 30 or less, those are guidelines. That's it. If you want to be a disruptor and break those guidelines, go ahead. There's no problem with that. Okay, because it just means you'll have to work a little bit harder. It'll be a little more difficult to rank on page one. But What that also means is that if you work harder at it, and it's more difficult, there's a larger reward at the end. Okay, enough of that. Let me go on to the next question. Thank you for that. And let me just delete that question here. Okay, next one. Appreciate the questions, by the way, and your patience for waiting for me to answer them. Let me get to this one. And let me paste this in here so people can see it, and the replays can pull them up too. All right, in the example you gave with the two home pages, site.com Dallas Plumber and site.com Dallas Havoc. What's the rest of the question, buddy? You got time. Type in the rest of the question if you're still on the call. Okay. There it is. Thank you. Let me copy that in. See, because the thing is that you can't see the chat box. I can. So, one of the members made a suggestion. Thank you, whoever you were. I think it was a girl. Havoc. What would the site.com Dallas page have on it? Good. Okay, good question. So, first of all, let's kind of walk through this. So you kind of decided that you've got... separate the questions here. Just separate this up a bit so it makes sense. Okay. So we have heating and cooling. It's kind of general plumbing. It can be, you know, installing copper pipes, hot water cooler, you know, hot water installation, which is a kind of an interesting fact. A side note, by the way, is that in the U.S., we've got these gigantic hot water heaters usually located in the garage. I mean, these things are mammoth, man. It's like this gigantic tub of water constantly being kept at a temperature of warm water. So that at any time you can take a warm shower, wash your clothes or whatever. Anyone know how the rest of the world does it? Well, not the rest, but the majority. You got this little tiny, tiny, tiny thing that like heats up the water only when you need it as it streams through. It's like 10,000% more efficient. Anyways. Let me get back to the question here. Two home pages on here, Dallas Plumber and Dallas Havoc. So you can have two pages, sort of like general plumbing and Havoc, heating and cooling. So what would the site.com Dallas page have on it? You wouldn't have a site.dallas page on it. You'd have a site.dallas/plumber and a site.dallas/havoc. You'd have no just Dallas page on it. Good question. Hope that cleared that up for a lot of people. Let me get rid of those questions on that. Okay, so since we have an email from our money site, should we? Okay, I'm just going to answer this without putting it in the question box because this is not a question I think would come up very often, but I want to answer it now. Since we have an email from our money site, which meaning from their money site, you know, like support@mymoneysite.com, should we consider an SSL? SSL is... special security if you're going to be transaction numbers. No, you don't need that kind of stuff. Don't worry about it. Okay, this is a good one. Let me, this is from Phil. And let me copy and paste this in here. And we'll get that going. Here we go. Bam. And Shazam. And delete question. Okay. How many Web 2.0s of the same type can you point to a money site before diminishing returns? You can point as many different types or same type of wealth tip owners as you want. It's not going to diminish a diddly squat. What you want to be concerned about on your Web 2.0s, however, is the quality content that's in there. So you want to make sure you have original content. You have really useful stuff on there. You don't have spammy backlinks going back out. In the course that I go over with backlinks, and this is not based on my personal opinion. This is based on going out and following like actual real life sites and looking at their backlink structure and looking at their anchor text. If they're using HFVH, Moz, which we all have commercial accounts for, and Majestica. And just really reverse engineering it. One out of 100, one keyword coming back just side of main one. That's a good ratio. But I go over more details in the course. So how many Web 2.0s are the same type? Can you point as many as you want before diminishing returns? There are none. As long as those are coming from different site owners. 10 tumblers at one money site. First of all, based on the example that I gave with the plumbers, you wouldn't give 10. Okay, because they got really crummy sites pointing at them. You just give one and do some crowd searches, and you're going to kick their butts totally. And I'm really curious, by the way. I'm going to do this on my other side. I've got another computer on here. So if you just bear with me. I'm really curious because I gave that towing example, right, in like Dallas, I think it was. And I just want you to kind of realize that page that was ranking page one with zero trust flow, you could totally, you could so kick their butt. Talking in front of the mic, you could so kick their butt. It's unbelievable. So I'm on a separate computer. Actually, yeah, my mastermind, I had two laptops opened up, and everyone there was giving me junk about it. That's the way I operate. So, Disruptor, don't listen to the comments. They don't know what they're doing anyways. Keyword. And what was that? I look in the chat box right now. What was the name of the city for the towing? Was it Houston? San Diego? Somebody type in if they can remember. Was it Houston? Was it? Oh, San Diego. Thank you very much. Okay. David, thank you. Okay, so let me just, I got a keyword planner on my other computer. It's giving me the same darn thing. They must have just changed something on here. This is bugging me. I like to figure things and find solutions when I figure things out. Hang on just 1 second for me, if you would. Just 2 seconds. There we go. I got it now. Hang on 1 second. Let me get this sucker done with. Not gonna let the Google stuff defeat me here, because I want to give you the total number of search volumes, because it's gonna kind of blow you away. I kind of know it will on here. So I'm just gonna, I kind of know this niche a little bit. Okay, so this is just kind of going on here. Look, if you're gonna do the Web 2.0s, there is no diminishing return as long as it's coming from different users of the same niche. Okay. Oh my God. Okay. Not working. Anyways, okay, so I apologize for that. Let me move on to the next question. I think I answered that, right? As long as you're on here. So let me mix up the questions. Wow, your timing couldn't be any better by sharing the Disruptor concept. Thank you. You are very welcome. Elon Musk, absolutely. Guys, just, wow. I'm going to like break open. The thing about Elon Musk, which is really cool, is that I've watched interviews. So he went to like Hong Kong and he spoke at an event there. While he was there in Hong Kong, trying to get this Tesla stations and stuff, power stations open up there. Hong Kong is actually quite popular for his Tesla models. And then I watched another presentation that he did in DC. And you can just tell when you look at him, it's like he's so freaking focused into his work. And it's like the focus is so intense. It's like you're so into what you're doing that you don't even feel you got to go pee. And you just pee your pants and you don't even feel it. You're just still working. That's the kind of state he's in. And you can totally notice it when he's on stage. It's like his eyes are kind of bug-eyed. And he's like, I really don't want to be here. Who are all these people? I just want to go back to work. Anyways. Okay. Okay. When we search for niches, all right, this is a pretty good question, even though I haven't read it all. I just read the first couple words. I'm going to go ahead and copy it. Put it in here. And Shazam. Okay, so here we go. When researching niches using the keyword planner tool, can you discuss the difference between keyword groups? Oh, this is a good question. Man, I wish I could log in on my keyword groups to really show you. And their volume searches versus exact word. Okay, so if you've gone into your keyword planner, you're like typing a word, you're going to get some exact match keywords and some suggestions for that, and you're going to get some groups, and those groups are for Google Plan Word groups. Don't get too distracted by the keyword groups, because the keyword groups are going to be like a group of keywords. If you were looking at this and using this for SEO, which it's not designed for, by the way, and they're looking at it as though you're going to buy AdWords. So kind of understand that difference. So they're going to give you the results by default for keyword groups. So you might type in, I don't know, towing. And then you go to the towing and it shows towing for a group of keywords. And there's 10 of them in there. And it says, whoa, we got 1,500 words per month in this group of towing Phoenix. And you're thinking to yourself, whoa, that's awesome. And then you open up the group and there's not 10 keywords in there, but there's like 20. And the vast majority have 10 searches, which with Google, when it has 10 searches, it really means like 0, 2, 3, and maybe 10. It's just their default. Notice they never give a keyword with 0, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, only with 10, which really means 0 to 10. And you open up that group and it goes, you know what? Here's towing for 270 per month. Here's like 40 other words, 10 each. And here's another one group for 10 each. And then here's a few more for like 20, 30, 40, and 50. You just focus on the main one, the highest one in each group. Okay? That's what you want to do. You only focus on the groups if you're doing paid Facebook advertising. We're doing SEO. So you kind of want to ignore the groups. But they know, but the groups are good to go in and then press the tab and look into them and then find the one word in that group of 10 or 20 that's got like at least, I don't know, 80 searches plus on it and add it to your list. I hope that answers your question. Don't worry about the language. I appreciate that. I kind of want to, I am kind of worried about the language, actually, because, you know, I post this stuff up, and some days my kids will watch it, and I don't talk this way around the house. And I don't want them to talk about it this way either. But I'll tell you this. I'm not going to mention the person's name, but the person is a multi, very close to billionaire. Which, how many millions of dollars does it take to be a billionaire? Anybody know? Type in the chat box if you know. How many? Really quickly, don't look it up on Google. It's not fair. First person, how many millions of dollars does it take? How many millions does it take to be a billionaire? 1,000. Nice job. Okay, so that's a heck of a lot of money. So somebody reported to be a pretty close to a billionaire. Great person. Many New York Times bestsellers and incredible companies. Spent a lot of time with him. That's one person. A second person. This particular person has huge teeth and is very tall and has lots of books with motivational stuff on it. You can probably figure it out by now. Anyways, these two people, online, in public, totally cool. Offline in person, dirtiest mouth you ever seen, like a drunken sailor. Okay. Oh my God, everybody got it right. I gave too many clues. Anyways, let me get back to the questions on here. Okay, so here looks like a... Okay, so this is what I'm talking about. Somebody just said, anyway, Eric, I apologize. Don't worry about it. No one's going to do it. Trust me. It takes too much work anyways. Just do more work than everyone else will do. You'll outlast them. Okay, so on here, thank you so much for towing 260, towing San Diego 480, San Diego towing 210. So that's like 800 searches in San Diego. I appreciate that for the feedback because I couldn't log in on mine. So anyways, I showed you what it takes to rank on page number one, and these are the number of searches. That's the unbelievable part. Just going through these on here. All right, so this is a good question here. So let me. They're all good questions on here. When I say it's a good question, I just mean what I'm going to put in the slides for later. So let me just put it in here for people who watch the replay. Okay, so do you start with a virtual address when getting started and switch to the Google Plus local method after you get a client and niche where there is an office in place? So with the Google Maps method that I use, and it works when you do it correctly. It doesn't require postcard verification. And it's not a hack, by the way. It takes like a lot of work to do. And the same work that you do to build this business up anyways. So it's not like you're doing all this work and then if you don't get the Google Maps, you know, all this for none. That's just not the case. Anyways, in the course, I think it's fairly clear. If it's not, just go to the chat box or the Facebook group and let me know it's not, and we'll work to improve that. But you really need to just follow every step from every single video up and take the action to do that. By the time you're at the module for the Google Maps listing, the little mini 3-pack, I kind of liked it when it was a better 7-pack. But anyways, when it was a 3-pack, it's how to get up there, how to do that without postcard verification. I go through the process in the module because so many people are asking, even though literally nobody is ready for it. Just out of pressure, I put the modules up, but I left 20% out. And the reason I left 20% out at the very end is that you got to do so many steps to kind of lead up to it. You know, you got to have a good quality site. You got to have like a Facebook. You got to have a Google Plus profile. You got to have a Facebook. You need to have some citations indexed. You need to have some local people searching for your site. You need to have some stuff in there, like it's a real freaking site. And then once you have that, then you're ready to rock and roll. And you follow the steps that I give you, and then I'll just give you the last couple of steps. I just don't want anybody to abuse it. That's all I'm saying. Because once the process gets abused, and it's going to get ruined, and Google will fill it out. So do we start with a virtual address? Yes. If you start in virtual address, if you start in module, it's either one or two. I believe it's two. I go over the methods clearly on how to check get an address and an address for Google Plus. If you're not quite sure then just skip up to, I think it's module 7, and I go over a couple other examples for the Google Maps, how to select an address, and some couple of other kind of high level stuff in there too. But none of it is enough to get you all the way to the finish line. And I'm not trying to mean with that or anything. I don't want anybody going through and like skipping all the way through and like shortcutting everything and then just like kind of going to, oh, I'm going to get a Google Plus. I'm going to get a Google 3-pack. And then they end up screwing it up for, or end up messing up for everybody else. I just don't want that to happen. So I hope you can understand that. Plus, you don't need to be in the 3-pack to be enormously successful at this. Okay, so I'm taking out some more questions here. Don't quite understand that one. Okay, good. This is a good question, so, and I actually forgot to address this, so thank you. Actually, Duke is coming up with a lot of good questions. Let me just copy and paste this in before I answer it. Let me remove it from there. Okay. So more backlinks to citations in the meanwhile versus direct. Good question. So here's the deal. Let's say that you've got your site. You built it the way that we recommend it. You've got an index the way we recommend it. And you're ready to rock and roll. And then you do the citations the way we recommend it. Understand the common knowledge and belief out there on how to do citations is extremely flawed. And it only benefits the people who own the citation companies. Enough said. If you want to learn more about that, go to the citation section in the course. But it's all a bunch of baloney. So I just give you my top 7. Just use 3. They're all do follow links. And we use those as tier 1s. Because of your question about more backlinks and citations, meanwhile versus direct, I'm going to guess that you know what tier 1 citations are. If you don't, go in the module about citations. I give a diagram about how to do that. So we use our citations basically as a way to like, hey, I'm valid, I'm cool, I'm doing a few citations. I'm okay. I'm not an abnormal person on here. I just did three. I didn't have to do 50. Which means if you do 50, you're going to get like, oh my goodness. If you did 50 citations, if you did like this White Sparks thing as a local business, this is such a joke. If you did like White Sparks or this YEXT and you're like, well, I'm not showing up on 30 of the most important citations. You better sign me up. You know how many freaking phone calls you're going to get per day? You're going to get like 100 phone calls per day. Oh, can I speak to the business owner? We'd really like, oh, we just noticed that your website was... They're just all lead gen sites. All citations are lead gen sites for companies that want to sell you stuff like SEO. That's what they are. Period. End of discussion. Wake up. And they've sold you that, and business owners, that you need them. You don't. So I've given you my top seven. Use Callzoo, the 2.0. When they try to call, the number's blocked. So, ha-ha. I want to say the S word to them right now because they deserve it, but I'm not going to. So how cool is that? You sign up, you get a do follow link, which by the way, these are like the only seven do follow links of all 100 citations out there. Cause they all just want to mess you over. Are you kidding me? I'm going to put on a site and I even give you a do follow link back to your site. Bah. But they're going to call you all day long. Oh, give me, can I speak to the business owner? And guess what? They even know the business owner's name because they require it when you fill it out. Which a bunch of baloney. But when we fill it out and we do it and you go through our system, they can't even call. It's like block. So you can get back to work. More backlinks to citations meanwhile. No, look, I give seven citations. You don't have to do all seven. I recommend three. That's it. Boom. Done deal. Wake up. It works. And we use those as tier ones. So, and you look at your competition from your Majestica backlink report, which we give you through Callzoo Majestica commercial account. And you look at their junk that they have and you go, you know what? I got nothing. I'm probably going to need like two above 10 trust flow, nice quality contextual backlinks, and I'm done. And that's all it takes. It's really that easy. I'm not talking about speed. Let me talk about just a little bit about this. Look, when you got a brand new site on Google, just accept it's going to take a while for them to accept you and to get up on page one, okay? It's just going to take a while. You got to take some patience. You can follow all the steps I'm going to show you, which is nothing aggressive. And one day you may wake up and your site is like on page three and you're like on top of the world. And you wake up the next day and you look on Google for it again and it's nowhere to be found. Nowhere to find. Found. And now your whole world has got a dark cloud over it and it's raining. That's called the Google dance. Just let it happen. And while you're letting it happen, do the crowd search. It's the safest thing you can do. It's impossible to get penalized by that, by the way. Do the 1 to 2 quality backlinks. Do some social bookmarking. That's really slow. Just take it easy. There's going to come a point to where your site is going to be ranking on page one above the fold. Above the fold means, you know, whatever you see on your screen. So it usually means in local, it really means like you're in the top three or four positions organically. Once you get that in like around seven cities or so, Google all of a sudden kind of gives you a, you know, not a go to jail card, a go to your cool card. And I'm telling you, it doesn't happen the same in every niche, obviously, but it'll happen early on. And then, you know, you're 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th, 13th, 14th, 15th, 16th, 17th, 18th, 19th, 20th, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 29, 30. The reason I said that every single number is kind of, I want you to kind of realize how many cities that is. They just kind of give you a go-to pass card for the rest of those cities. It's like, oh, yeah, you're a franchise company. Yeah. Or they think of you on as, yeah, you've already been ranking really good in your first 7 cities and your 8th one and your 9th one. You're not spending spammy backlinks and you got good quality content and stuff we want to deliver to our end users. Yeah, you got to go to page 1 go card anytime you want to go. So wait for that. But you got to be patient. In the beginning, you can't start throwing a bunch of crap. You can't start throwing a bunch of stuff at your site. Then you're going to end up in never, 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 never land. Okay? Slow it down. Slower is always better. When in doubt, slow it down. It will pay off in huge dividends. When you get that, reach that tipping point, you're 7, 8, 9, it's everyone's a little bit different. It depends on the niche. Look, I showed you an example on the towing, right? Zero trust flow. Citation 15 equals spam. You come in there with a nice site and you're doing what I tell you to do with the every activity on that website has to do with their local IP address. Google already loving you. You have a Google Webmaster tool that you've done with a Gmail account that you've already verified from a local number. Google really loving you. Are you starting to see what's happening here? Okay. Ain't nobody talking about this stuff, folks. Then you go on to the forums locally and you find some forums and you start commenting and you're active in that. You start going to some of the news stations, the radio, the newspaper, the television. You start interacting, adding some comments, some smart comments back. Are you starting to see how this works? Okay. This is what they're looking for. It's gaming the system. You always get a game the system. I'm sorry. This is what it's about. And then you come up with a Web 2.0 from somebody else, not logging in with your profile. Okay. Don't do that. And you got a really good quality link coming into your site. Yeah. Are you starting to see how you can totally freaking dominate this stuff? But it doesn't happen overnight because every other, I was just having one of the guest speakers is going to come in and speak at the Vegas event. I was talking on Skype with him right before the call. And I said, whoa, I looked at the time. I was like, oh, my goodness, it's like 8 minutes before the webinar is going to start. I got to go. Take care. Ciao. And we were talking about, you know, how all the shiny objects are out there. But it's not just the shiny objects. It's the shiny objects themselves. I'm really convinced if the shiny objects worked the way they claim they would, I'd just be like, go for it. The problem is they don't. Running a business, a real business, takes more than just like one little fancy little thing, okay? Please realize that. Look, I built my business and had a lot of hard times with it and hired a lot of really good coaches, helped me out, people that are much smarter than me, to formulate my hiring process, completely refine that, my management process, how I communicate to my main people. I had a really hard time with that in the beginning. And I still do today. That'll kind of peep up. So if you like do stuff on Facebook and ask some questions, I'll come in a little bit tough love, maybe a little bit too hard. It's hard for me to break away from that. And I, but when I deal with staff with that, they just break apart. They just like crumble. It's like crash and burn. Plane coming in from the runway and they're just rocking back and forth. It just like tumbles and explodes. Yeah, and I've done it way too many times. So you need to learn how to run a business. You need to learn all the ins and outs of it, because we're not joking around here, because the rewards are so fantastic at the end. And, you know, I don't know. I mean, there's been so many out there, all this like, you know, I came from this incredible hard background and look at me now, blah, blah. That's been so abused. I almost don't even want to discuss mine, which mine is freaking real. But there's such an amazing feeling when you've come from nothing, seriously, nothing. And you just kind of move forward and you make an incredible amount of mistakes, but you're willing to raise your hand. You got to raise your hand and say, I need help. I'm messing up here. What the hell's going on? And then you can get help from expert people and correct those things and then take off, you know. And I don't know, and I'm not trying to get you guys to do this. That's not what it's about, but I mean, I post on my personal but public YouTube channel, I post all kinds of stuff, you know. I mean, me and my kids and stuff, we travel all over the freaking world. I really feel good about that, because I know my kids, I know they're, all three of my kids are American born, but they have currently and will spend 80-90% of their early adulthood life until they're 20 outside of the U.S. And they are fluent in, fluent in Korean, obviously fluent in English, and almost fluent in Spanish. And we have tutors that come over and help them a couple nights a week, too. That's going to change their freaking lives and the potential they have to change in the world. So whatever your why is, think about that. Think about your why. Alrighty, so what's the top of the hour here? Let me look at it. Alrighty, so I'm good for another 20 more minutes. And we'll go through these questions on here. And if when I go through these questions, if you got like an urgent question, and those of you who are active in the community, you know we have some pretty darn good support. It's not perfect, but it's pretty god darn good. If there's a question I don't answer for you tonight, send it in to support, okay? Because that way it gets logged in. And there's an incredible amount of management team on the support desk. So just realize that it's not like you just enter in your support ticket and enter it in. It's like, just kind of goes off and it's like, someone will answer it. No, there's an entire structure behind the whole thing. So anyways, let me go through here randomly. Okay, let me answer this from Bob. And Bob, I totally appreciate you hanging for a long time. He's just a regular customer on here. Bob, I would love to see you in Vegas, by the way. And I didn't see anything come up with that. So if there's something holding you back from coming to Vegas, even if we're sold out, I'll make it happen for you, because I remember your name. I'm not going to mention your last name because I want to keep your privacy, but I see your questions come up all the freaking time, which is good. So anyways, if you want some kind of special to happen, just go to the support desk and I'll make sure it happens. Okay, so let me get in Bob's question here. Okay, every time we add a new city, okay, so you add like, you know, Houston, Texas, Fort Worth, Austin, blah, 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 we need to go back to all the home pages and service pages, and by the way, post pages, as well as, yeah, post, he already knows that, and add the link to the city. Correct. Correctamundo. Good question. Yes, you do. Let me delete that. More questions. Do we have anybody on the call yet? I just been kind of rambling. Holy smokes. We have so many people on the call. Okay. All right. Folks, answer your give your questions in here. Alrighty, so I'm not going to put this in the question box, but I'm going to answer it just verbally. So Eric asks, how much was the event? If you're a causing member, the event is nothing. How amazing is that? I completely missed this one. Well, it's not done with yet. We've still got 6 spots left. You can't stay at the mansion that we ordered, but you can stay. There's another place just down, like literally 10 minutes walk on the same street. You just keep walking, boop, 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 10 minutes. You know, if you jogged it, you'd drive in 4. You can come stay with us, you know, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. And you can enjoy everything. We're going to have Friday. We're going to have Friday is just 5 p.m. to 11. We'll probably go later. You know how people are. We're going to have a barbecue. We're going to have stuff to eat, drink, and talk. And it's just a chance to kind of get to know everybody. Just kind of roll your, you know, take off your jacket, take off your, you know, your persona, and just relax, you know. So there's always an opportunity. Okay, here's another one. I didn't have a chance to sign up for the Vegas, but will you be recording it for the rest of us? Yes, I will, Bob, but Bob, contact support. You need to come. I want to make it happen for you, whatever it takes. So, contact support. I've been seeing your good messages and your good questions for too long. You need to make face-to-face ability contact. Trust me, it will bring your game to a new level, and I'm willing to help you with that. So anyways, I don't have a chance to go to Vegas, but yes, I'll be recording it. But man, yes, of course I'll be recording it. It's going to be some amazing content, so I got to record it. It's repurposable, so yeah, we'll be doing that. But there's just no comparison to recording versus being there. None whatsoever. Here's a random question on here, and our statement or comments or commentary. So it doesn't go on the question on here. I like it when you ramble or rant. It shows that you are simply giving who you are. And your journey, I like your foul language. Okay, thanks. I got so many votes for foul language, and I appreciate that. Thank you so much for that. But I'm going to really work on reducing that down, just for family stuff, and also because not just family stuff, because I want my kids to listen to this and gain value from it. But in Tokyo, we're going to be doing some live events, and my kids are going to be up on stage. They're going to be talking about the store that they learned how to operate through me, the Shopify. And I just don't want their kind of stuff that they do like me with language on it here. When is the next mastermind? Will you have it again in Vegas next year? Okay, great question. That's probably good enough to put in the chat box. Actually, no. So look, the masterminds, the deep intensive masterminds, that is going to be held on Monday in Vegas, but Sunday and Saturday are the intensive workshops for the members. Okay. And then the masterminds are year long, and we meet in person twice, all of us. And then we have 4 intensive 5 to 6 hour Skype interviews. There's a private Skype group. And then optional, you can come and meet up with me and whoever wants to show up in Hong Kong, Tokyo, or Korea, which I would encourage you to do. It will literally change your life. Love the passion and the mindset talk. John, thank you for that. I appreciate the feedback. Okay, so I'm just right now kind of thumbing through the questions. If I'm a little bit kind of silent or not thumbing along, that's why. Okay, so. I haven't even read this question, but it looks long, so I'm just going to go ahead and just copy and paste it. And when I get into, paste it into the, questions, I'll answer it then. Hopefully there's nothing. Alrighty, so let me move this out of the way. Alright, so here we go. And who delivered this? Dallas, thank you so much. Appreciate the question. Here we go. A question about registering domains names. It's a good question, by the way. I know there's a lot of confusion around that. If all the good domains have been taken, can I use the air? Wait a minute. I'm already confused. Let me start from the beginning. A question about registering domain names. If all the good domains have been taken, can I use the area code instead of the city name, like 623handyman.com, or does the city name need to be in the domain? Such as 603 Phoenix. Can you elaborate on this? All right. I'm going to elaborate on this, and I might go majorly off on this. Hang on 1 second. Let me get a little drink for this. Okay. So here we go. First of all, thank you for sending the question. My reaction to it, don't take it the hard way. It's just tough love. And it's going to be the correct answer. And that's what you're seeking anyways, right? So don't take my answer as defense to justify your current position. So here we go. First of all, just don't do the just don't take the area code and the domain name on here. Let's just throw that whole concept like out the window, like really fast and like as far as you can, just get rid of it. It's a really bad idea. No problem. You're thinking outside of the box, and I encourage that. Continue to think outside of the box, but definitely, you know, ask for some feedback on it. Okay, so here's with domain names. Let me just kind of jump right to the punch. Domain names for your niche need to be a branded name, not a keyword-rich domain name. And not a keyword-rich domain with an area code or anything like that. Because what you want to do is you want to take this one domain name and develop it out into 50-plus areas. And you simply cannot do that if you're going to name your domain name an area code. Excuse me, an area code plus whatever name you want to give it. .com just doesn't work. You want to be thinking about Roto-Rooter. They are certain Roto-Rooter. Let's just look that up right now. I mean, forget giving me an example on that. Let's just look it up right now. So, because you don't want to be looking at examples that so-called gurus give and everybody else. Let's just talk about real life. I don't even know how to spell it. I hope that's it. Yeah. Okay, so I want to do just bear with me for a second. Even see my keyboard. I didn't even realize I gotta look at my keyboard. My bad. Major bad. Okay, so I got my head a little bit away from the mic, so. It did. So here's the example. Roto-Rooter Phoenix. So this is a national franchise. So let's just see. Yeah, so they're right here. So they're rated at number one, which does not surprise me at all. Let's take a look at their site. Notice how they have it. Like, I love this. Roto-Rooter, which is a brand name. /Phoenix, not Roto-Rooter. Oh, jeez. That's my internet connection, by the way. I apologize for that. Hopefully, I wasn't everybody cut off. So let's come back here. Where are we? Right here. Number one. Roto-Rooter, brand name, .com, /Phoenix. Not, you know, something like, you know, Plumbers in Phoenix. You want to think national. So there is no, like, look, folks, they're rating number one. And they're rating number two right up here in the Google 3-pack. In other words, they're kicking some major bum bum. So come up here. And they are doing what? Roto-Rooter. Do you see any plumbing? This is a huge freaking lesson, folks. And gals, listen to this. Watch this. And in the training modules, I give, you know, like 20 to 30 minute training videos. And I know that's like, you know, everyone else is like, no. We're going to give training of 5 minutes because that's all you can handle. No, I'm just giving you the real freaking deal, right? What do you want to do? You want to spend, you know, the measly money you spend with me to do this? Or do you want to spend, you know, $10,000 per quarter to a community college or a regular college for what? A bunch of junk, outdated junky junk. Oh man, I wanted to say so many swear words right there. You can't believe it. No, of course you don't. So anyways, that's it right there. /Phoenix. Guess where they're located? In every freaking city in the United States. What do we not see here? / the state name? No, because I go back to everything I said before earlier. What do you want to do? The shortest URL possible. And there is no other Phoenix. And if there's another Phoenix in the United States, it's so freaking small, 20 or 30,000 people, it's not going to bring you enough searches to matter. You understand that? And you do not use rotorooter.com/Phoenix Plumbers. No, no, no. Too spammy. I hope that makes sense. And I've done all this in the training, so I really hope that makes sense. Marcus asks, yes, Roto-Rooter, how do they get the stars? As, very good question. In fact, I'm going to save that question because it is a really good question. And I'm going to answer beyond what you think I'm going to. But first, I need to enter it in here. Alrighty, so let me begin. Marcus, thank you for the question. I hope it's okay. I mentioned first names. I will never do last because you probably want to keep some kind of anonymity. How the heck do they still get the stars on the pages like the ones I just showed? I was just on the page and they got stars on it. Everyone's like, why do they get those stars? Because obviously, if you're ranking organically and you have the little star ratings, and some people right now are watching, you're probably wondering what the heck all the star ratings are. I'll show you. It's right there. How are they getting these? We kind of figure out the Yelps, how they're getting them, but how is this site getting these? Easy. If you know how. And as a Kazoo member, active member of the 2.0, you'll be given access to that very shortly, trust me, because we want you to succeed. And obviously, with the start, look, let's be a little bit honest. If I was scrolling down and this had no stars, but I saw this last star, I'd probably click here, right? Bingo. We don't mess around here. Okay, that's it. I'm going to call it a break. We are all done for the evening. I'm going to give 2 minutes, though, for very, very last, like, urgent questions. Like, I cannot leave unless this question is answered. I've been there before, so if you've got one of those, just type it in. I will answer that. It'll be the very last question. That's it. 1, 2, 3, we're done. Okay, so thank you very much for everybody who's joined. I'll talk to you on the next call. Take care. Bye-bye.